In this video, I talk about the Marvel Star Wars comics panel that took place at Star Wars Celebration. I was there and I listened to what they had to say, and I'm going to give you my thoughts. What is up, YouTube? It's Josh. This is the Den of Nerds. So this video is going to be a little bit weird for a number of different reasons, but basically, if you've been watching the channel recently, you know I have been very critical of Marvel comics as of late. And some of that has been aimed directly at some of their Star Wars books. Darth Maul. Well, I thought, since I was at Star Wars Celebration, why not go to the Marvel panel to see what they had planned for the future of Star Wars comics? I thought that would be stuff that you guys would enjoy, and I did so, and I'm going to break down pretty much everything that we went over during the panel. I'm going to throw up some images I took, and also at the end of the video, I'm going to tell you a very weird story about a person that showed up on the panel. Okay, so let's get right into it. So the first thing that was talked about was the Screaming Citadel comic. Now, this is going to be a five-part crossover where Dr. Aphro and the Luke Skywalker book, or maybe just the main Star Wars book, I'm not really sure, crossover and do this little mini-series called Screaming Citadel, seemingly about a Screaming Citadel. So the cool thing about this book and what people are looking forward to is the fact that it is actually going to explore some really interesting parts of canon when it comes to different ways of knowing and using the Force. This is something we've been talking about as a community since Lucasfilm was bought by Disney. There has been this big emphasis on the gray and on getting to know the Force in different ways from different points of view. You have the Night Sisters. You have the Knights of Ren, you have the Church of the Force, you have the Wills, and now you seemingly have some other kind of thing going on here at the Screaming Citadel. I'm going to put up a panel of interiors where basically Luke Skywalker and Dr. Aphro and her team are pulling up to the Screaming Citadel, and these people over here look pretty weird, man. This looks like definitely some dark side kind of people. There's this armored guy appearing to hold a lightsaber, so maybe Luke is going to get in a lightsaber fight with this person, which could be really cool. This takes place between A New Hope and Empire. This has been the big time period that Marvel chose to focus on, which, you know, is not my favorite thing for them to focus on, but I guess it kind of makes sense. You have to remember, in the original Star Wars trilogy, there was big gaps of time, up to 3 years in canon, that was completely skipped over before going into the next film. So Marvel aimed to kind of fill that out. So basically what this could mean is, if this is a lightsaber battle, and if this is some kind of crazy knowledge of the Force, this would be stuff that Luke had been exposed to before even facing off against Vader, before even meeting Master Yoda and getting that training on Dagobah. So really, really interesting stuff. I'm interested to see how that all plays out. The next thing that we went into was the Captain Phasma book. This got, I think, announced at this panel, and it will focus, of course, on Captain Phasma, and they talked about how this will focus around the story of how she escapes Starkiller Base at the end of The Force Awakens. So kind of a cool thing here, and I want to pause for just a moment and talk about the changes that have been made to Marvel Star Wars comics that I think are actually really good. So when Marvel Star Wars comics first got announced and Jason Aaron just started doing the Star Wars book and there was the Vader book and all these other things kept coming out, I think that what was really happening was the story group didn't have a clear idea of what they wanted to do with the Star Wars comics. They more or less went to the comic book writers and asked them if they wanted to make stories in this time period. It is my understanding that the writers then pitched story ideas that the story group kind of was like, okay, well, that's interesting. We can fit that in here. You gotta change this, yada, yada, yada. So a very strange way to go about, you know, making the books and working in this process. But I think one of the things that was lost was the fact that we as Star Wars fans really want not just stories that take place in these time periods, but things that have resonance to the overall canon, things that matter for these characters. And we really just want cool, awesome bits of canon. One of the big problems is you're putting these familiar characters in familiar settings and having familiar outcomes. After a while, that's going to get really old. The Star Wars book, for me, although really well written, doesn't really hold my interest. It's not something that I really enjoy reading over and over again or serially at all, really. There are certain story arcs I'll check out, certain issues I'll check out. Like, I liked the Yoda arc when he's with those rocks and the kids and whatnot. I thought that was cool with the journal of Ben Kenobi and stuff like that. But there's really not a lot in there for me to dig into as a lover of this canon. So I think what they have done is they have changed that, and now they are focusing on interesting pieces of canon and filling those out in interesting ways. And that will kind of take me into some of the books later. But we definitely want to know more about Captain Phasma. She was completely underutilized in The Force Awakens. And that scene at the end with Han Solo and Finn, I mean, yo, she kind of got punked in that scene, which is ridiculous. She's supposed to be this badass warrior. So I really want to see how she escapes that situation and what she does from there. Because we see her in the Last Jedi trailer walking through the flames. So, I mean, it's like some WWE stuff. Like, she came to fight, man. It's round two, so to speak. So I'll be interested to check that one out. The next book that was announced was the Rogue One comic book. This is, of course, the adaptation of that movie in comic book form. You know, I this might interest you, this might not interest you. One thing that I will say that was brought up at the panel that I thought was pretty cool was that the editors actually reached out to Gareth Edwards and basically were like, is there anything that happened in this story that you wanted to have in the film but you had to cut it out because of time constraints? And Gareth apparently came back to them with this really, really like lengthy document that was basically like, if this movie was 5.5 hours, this is all the stuff I would have wanted to have in it. They cleared it through story group. It's canon, so there's going to be cool stuff in that Rogue One book. Might be enough for me to check it out. I'm not exactly sure yet. I didn't read The Force Awakens adaptation in comic book form. I had it in my hands yesterday, actually, when I was buying these Johns, and I was thinking about getting it, but I just couldn't pull the trigger on it. Not excited enough about it. But might be something that you're into. The next book was, of course, this Darth Vader book. Now, this is the book that we've been kind of hearing about. It's been building a little bit of buzz. This takes place directly after the no! From Vader. And essentially what's going on here is Vader, it was really cool to listen to Charles Soule talk about this and talk about this character and where he put himself as Vader while writing. It's like he looks in the mirror for the first time and really sees what he has become. And he has two choices. He either has to like embrace this thing, embrace what he is and embrace what he has to do, or he'll go mad and he might as well just kill himself, essentially, I think is what he was implying. So it's very interesting. I'm gonna be interested to check that out. There's also this shot that they showed us. And Charles said that he never thought this would go through the story group. And that is because this is Darth Vader slamming the Emperor against the wall with the power of the Force. So at the end of Sith, when Vader is having his tantrum and killing all those droids, he never affects the Emperor, right? Well, literally a couple seconds later, apparently he does. And this is canon now. So Vader was so angry that he slams the Emperor against the wall. I find that pretty cool, man. And I think obviously if you see that smile in the last panel, the Emperor, it's not like he's gonna just take that or whatever. So I'll be very interested to see where we go from here in that story. But also wanted to note this. The story focuses a lot on how Vader goes and gets his red kyber crystal. Now, in the Ahsoka novel, it is explained that when a Sith will basically find a kyber crystal or steal a kyber crystal, presumably from a Jedi they have killed, they can put their power into it, which causes this effect called bleeding, because the kyber crystals are these peaceful things that almost have like a mind to them, right? They're like the wands in Harry Potter. They know the person they're supposed to be with. And so that relationship, when corrupted, that causes this thing called bleeding, where the kyber crystals turn red. It's very, very cool. That was delved into in the Ahsoka novel, but we never get to see what that looks like. But we will get to see what that looks like in this Darth Vader comic, which, for me, a huge Vader fan, yes, like, that's awesome. That's something I'm definitely going to be looking forward to checking out. So that was a pretty cool announcement right there. Then I want to talk for very briefly about the toy covers. Okay, so John Tyler Christopher was on the panel, and he spoke about the covers that he did, which are, of course, these old nostalgic action figure covers. And honestly, I'm not super into alternative covers or anything like that, and I'm not a huge collector of Star Wars memorabilia or action figures, but it was really cool to listen to the passion that this guy had for his collecting and how that comes across in his art. Like, for instance, he will make certain mistakes on purpose because that was the way those toys were back then. There was a certain charm to them because they were incorrect to their movie counterparts and sometimes incorrect to even what was on the back of their box. So very, very cool stuff. If you're a huge Star Wars nerd, you might want to check these things out because I'm telling you, this guy really knows his stuff, and there's little details in there that I think you'll really be able to appreciate as a fan. Now, the last thing that they talked about was the Obi-Wan and Anakin book. This was a book that is almost like a Clone Wars book, right? This is presumably the same time period of Clone Wars, even though it's actually when he's like much, much younger, pretty much just becoming a Padawan from the look of these interiors. And I don't know, man, it's a cool relationship. I like that part of Star Wars canon, but I can't honestly say that it's something I really, really want to check out. I mean, like I said before, if there's some kind of awesome bit of canon that happens, I'll definitely check that out. That sounds great, but my thoughts are probably that it's gonna more or less just retrace themes that are, you know, between those two and whatnot like that. So now, you know, they were kind of impassioned when they were talking about it, like, he's just a kid, he has no idea, man, he's this 9-year-old kid, and this space wizard invites him and just boom. And that's really, really cool. Like, I'm not saying that's not cool, but compared to some of the other things that were announced and some of the other places that were going, just, I don't know, man, didn't necessarily excite me all that much. But now let me talk to you about something that happened that was kind of awkward right away when I went into this panel. And to be honest, like, I thought about not talking about this, but essentially, like, you guys and the guys that watch this channel and that have checked out my comic book videos, I don't know, man, I feel like I owe you a little bit of like realism here, a little bit of like truth. And that's all. I don't want to oversell it or whatever, but basically, so I'm an indie comics book writer as well. And there is an editor that works at Marvel who I essentially hired her freelance to look over a pitch document for a comic book that is coming out for me very soon. It's a cyberpunk Robin Hood book. You might have heard me talk about it a little bit in other videos. But she essentially helped me out with the script and the pitch document for this comic, and to be completely real with you, she shredded it, man. My first draft, the draft that I gave her, she absolutely shredded it, but also, to her credit, brought up some really good points, and from her notes, I actually constructed what I think was the best issue number one I've ever written, and I'm very, very excited about where the future of that book goes. But here's what's funny, so she's actually on the panel. Like, when they come out, she's literally up there, because she's an assistant editor at Marvel, and she's up there talking about, you know, the Star Wars books that she works on and stuff. And it was this surreal thing. But here's where it gets weird. So when I was negotiating with her, and Heather, if you're watching this, like, you know, I'm just being real about this. I'm just being real about it. So what happened was, she did not want me to leverage the fact that she works at Marvel in order to sell the book, which is completely fair. It completely makes sense. Her freelance stuff is kind of separate, obviously. And, you know, she's not an editor on the book. She just helped with the pitch document. So I completely understand that. And I'm not saying she's the editor. But because of that, I was left in this weird spot where it's like, well, what do I say? How do I talk about this? Because it was weird. It was also really cool, man. Like, a person that helped me with a comic book that I've talked comic shop with is on the celebration, you know, stage up there talking with these other guys about Marvel Comics. So it was just kind of a cool thing that happened, but also kind of weird. Like right away, the whole panel, like my thing was like, oh my God, is that Heather? Like this is crazy. And, you know, it was bizarre. But I want to finish the video by talking about the faith that I have in Marvel Comics. Because here's the thing, I've been coming down really hard on Marvel, and my honest opinion about this is, and I think that this will come across the more that you watch my content, the more that you spend time with me in these videos or whatever, my thing is not to, on one side or the other, bash anything unfairly or attack anything for the sake of attacking it. It is my opinion that we have to be critical of moves that are being made by big entities in the industry that we love. So if you love comics, and I'm pretty invested in it, I write comics, I produce comics, I spend money to make my comics and things like that. So I'm invested in this industry, literally invested. And when these things are happening that are turning off a ton of readers, including myself, to a lot of things, I just feel a responsibility to speak up about it. And there are a lot of things that are going on with Marvel right now that are bad. And I've spoken about the PR thing. I couldn't, you know, when I get fired up, you know, I curse a lot, and I don't think I've cursed in this video, but that really fucking pissed me off. It really, really did. And I honestly think that it's garbage. And anybody who tries to defend that position and everything like that is garbage. I get a little irritated. But at the end of the day, the care they are taking with the Star Wars books is good. They had made some missteps. There were things they did that just didn't work, and I didn't hear them complain. Like, you know, when certain books didn't succeed, I didn't hear them blame the fans, which was dope, by the way. And then they made this switch to a better way of telling stories that focus on aspects of canon. And I think that's a very good move. I don't know how they came to this conclusion or whatever, but that's a good move, and I have to applaud them for that. I am legitimately excited to read a lot of these titles, which is really, really cool. It literally has nothing to do with the superhero line at Marvel. I have a lot of problems with that line. There are books that I like on it. Love the Thanos book right now. That book is awesome. Infamous Doom is great. But, you know, overall, I have a lot of problems with what they're doing. I hear a lot of you guys in the comment section. So there's a lot of mudslinging and whatnot that goes on in the comment section. Whatever. Your business, not mine. But I think that I just want to make it clear that I am not saying that, like, it's over for me as a Marvel fan. I'm not completely boycotting them. I'm upset at some things that happened, very much so. But I trust that they will be able to correct course, hopefully, and continue to put out great comics. I mean, I'm a huge Marvel fan. I love Marvel Comics, but I'm not going to just drink the Kool-Aid whenever they just try to feed me stuff that's not story first, stuff that is, you know, PR marketing stuff, that I'm not going to sit by for it. So I just wanted to kind of put that out there, because I think that some of the energy that I put out when I get mad, and, you know, it's fine, because, you know, I'm happy to put that content out there and really call them out on it. I really am. I'm going to do that. But I also think that I should probably not dial it back, but let you guys know where I stand on it. Like, that's straight up where I stand on it. One of the things that I want to build as a part of my personal brand on whatever this is, this YouTube video thing, whether, you know, on Instagram or whatever, even in my comics, is that I want to be real about this. I just want to give my honest opinion. When I see something is wrong, when I see a situation headed south, I'm just going to say that. I'm going to call it like it is. And so that's pretty much all I wanted to say about that. But overall, I was really happy with the Marvel Star Wars panel. I thought it was really cool. There's a lot of books that I'm looking forward to. But what do you think? Was there anything that I talked about that really excited you? Was there something that you wanted to see come out of the Star Wars Marvel comics that you didn't? And what would that be? Love to have a conversation about all of that in the comment section below. As I always say, I hope you're having an awesome and nerdy day. See ya!